So today's topic, you can do that with a private foundation. I've been practicing saying that. How did that come about? It's come about because over the years, clients have shared with me their aspirations for their foundations. And they told me about all the things they want to do. And at some point, almost inevitably, the conversation will take a sort of a wistful turn. And they'll tell me about all the things they wish they could do with their foundation if only they could. And I say, but you can do those things. And they'll say, you can do that with a private foundation? So in homage to those clients, those conversations, we put together a little overview today, going over and touching on some of those topics, starting with grants individuals. So many are surprised to learn that foundations, unlike donor-advised funds, can make grants individuals. In fact, there's quite an array of different types of grants that can be made to individuals. Of course, it's key to follow the proper procedures when doing so. But assuming as always that the grant is furthering a charitable purpose, the foundation as a first step should determine whether or not advance IRS approval is needed. So the thing is, when the IRS reviews, they don't actually review each grant one at a time. It's generally a one-shot endeavor. And the approval is intended to determine whether or not the foundation's program, as it's articulated in its application or request for approval, is going to be run in a fair and even-handed way. And the thing is, there's a lot of confusion about when do you need approval, when don't you need approval. And the way it was explained to me many years ago by the former chief of EO Technical, his name was Mark Friedlander, retired a number of years, he used to talk to me about strings. And he'd say, you don't need approval, Jeff, if you don't have any strings. So what do you mean by that? So he'd say, well, look, the thing is, strings mean that if I give someone a grant, I have a string attached to the grant. I expect them to do something in exchange for the grant funds, whether to teach in a public school system for a number of years after receiving the grant, whether to author a book or sculpt a sculpture or whatever it might be, there is an expectation or requirement that they do something. There's a quid pro quo. On the other hand, if there are no strings attached to the grant, they don't have to do anything with the grant funds, you generally don't need advance approval. Examples of that would be emergency grants, hardship grants, or even awards for past accomplishments. So, in particular, if there is a string, you don't even then always need advance approval. You only need advance approval, for example, if the string has to do with travel, study, or similar purposes. Let me explain the difference. Let's say you make a grant to someone, an emergency grant. They can't afford to pay their heating bill. It's freezing outside. And so you say, look, I'll give you a grant, but I want to use it to pay your heating bill. So that's a string, but it has nothing to do with travel, study, or similar purposes, and it furthers a charitable purpose. On the other hand, if I give someone a string and say, I'm giving you these funds, but I want you to go to school. This is a scholarship grant. I expect you to graduate and maintain a minimum GPA. Or if I have a less traditional, but perhaps more innovative type of grant, where I say, look, I'm going to make this grant to you, but in exchange, I want you to author a book. I want you to paint a mural. I want you to compose a musical score or choreograph a ballet or develop some other skill, capacity, or talent of the grantee. Those are also grants that require advance approval. And whenever you make a grant to an individual, it's necessary to report that grant on the foundation's annual return, the 990PF. Now, this diagram, if you can read it, we'll actually have handouts for you later, and magnifying glasses too. It's meant to help you figure out when you need advance approval, and it takes into account these key concepts, like whether or not there's a charitable purpose, whether or not there's a broad charitable class that I'll get to in a second, whether or not there are strings requiring the recipient to do something, and whether or not there's a prize or award program. Sometimes, to be honest, it can be kind of unclear. Sometimes it can be more of an art than a science. You're not really quite certain whether or not you need advance approval. Could happen. In a case like that, I always recommend that you try to get the advance approval. And here's why. I don't see a way you could lose. If you tell the client up front and set their expectations and say, look, Bob, you know, it's possible that the IRS may come back and say, you don't need approval. But don't think that I'm running up a bill because it's still worthwhile to do. Here's why. If you need advance approval, you'll have the advance approval. If you don't need the advance approval, they'll refund your user fee, plus they'll send you correspondence that you don't need it. And if you're ever audited down the road and they say, how come you didn't get advance approval from this program? They'll say, what do you want from me? I applied for it, but you said I didn't need it. You're coming after me now? So either way, the whole point of doing this is to insulate your client from liability or potential liability from the IRS. So it seems like a worthwhile thing to do. And after explaining that to our clients inevitably say, you know, why not? Let's do it. In terms of grants individuals, there are certain threshold requirements, almost universal requirements, for all grants individuals, whether IRS approval is needed or not. So, for example, a foundation can never make a grant to an insider, or in the terms of the code of the regulations, a disqualified person, because doing so would result in a self-dealing violation. There also must be a broad charitable class. I mentioned that a moment ago. And what that means is that the number of people comprising the class of eligible grantees has to be open-ended, not finite. Here's an example of what I mean by that. I'm trying to say that you can't look at the class and reduce the members of the class to a discrete list. So if I say, I'm going to institute a scholarship program for all the students graduating from Orlando High School in 2017, that's a finite list, right? I could write down a list and say, you know, Bob's in the order, you know, it might be a very long list, but I could have a list. It's finite. On the other hand, if I say, I'm going to make a grant, and it's going to be for the current graduating class from Orlando High School and future graduating classes, well, you know, I defy anyone to try to write down that list. Unless you're a prophet, you don't know who's going to be graduating from Orlando High School 10 years from now, right? It could be almost anyone. That's an open-ended list. That's a broad charitable class. Now, in order to have a broad charitable class, there's inevitably this component of publicizing the existence of the scholarship program. Because if you think about it, if no one knows about the scholarship program's existence but you and your staff, or you, your counsel, who's going to know about the program? There really won't be a broad charitable class. The charitable class will be very small. It'll be confined to those actually known by the folks who are on the foundation. It'll shrink dramatically. And so, as a consequence, then people will always ask me, well, does that mean that I can't make a grant to people I know? This is from the president or the vice president or whatever. And so, you know, look, all because you know someone doesn't mean that they're automatically disqualified just because you happen to know them. But I always say, but you can't grant only to people you know. So, in theory, you should have channels of getting the word out, whether or not you're working maybe with a clergyman or with a social worker, or maybe someone at the hospital, the emergency room, or the police, or whatever it might be, way to ensure a flow of future eligible grantees to make the group broader and more open-ended in nature. Also, the grant has to be fair and even-handed in the terms, again, of the IRS and the code, the regs. They talk about objective and non-discriminatory procedures for ensuring, again, that the program is run fairly. And so what they mean, for instance, there is that if I have a scholarship program for biochemistry majors, for instance, it wouldn't be very logical, would it be, if I were to say the only people who are eligible to participate in this biochemistry major scholarship are people with red hair, blue eyes, and pink ties. So it has to be a logical relationship. So whether that's academic excellence, maybe character, showing an interest in science or chemistry or what have you, those would be logical kinds of relationships. And of course, it's necessary to comply with the record keeping rules for all grants individuals. And those requirements can vary depending on the nature of the grant. And in some cases, like in the context of a natural disaster, those rules are somewhat relaxed. Now, if advance approval is needed, there is an overlay of additional rules. For instance, in a rare nod to practicality, the regulations instituted a special 45-day rule. That rule says that 45 days after filing a properly submitted request for IRS approval, the foundation can start making grants to individuals if the foundation has not been notified in the interim that its procedures are unacceptable. That could be very useful because if you want to institute a scholarship program and students have to apply to colleges and so forth, they can't wait for the IRS to take 6, 8, 9 months, whatever, to decide that it's okay before you can make the grant. So that's the rare nod to practicality. On the other hand, I always feel very nervous for clients, you know, that want to rely on the 45-day rule because, you know, the trick there is that they say properly submitted applications. So what if they say it hasn't been properly submitted because you left out this element or that element or whatever of the program and therefore it's incomplete and therefore not properly submitted. Therefore, you don't get the 45-day rule. But generally, if a client wants to do that, the 45-day rule is a well-respected, well-known exception. And just be very careful, you know, when you're working with your clients or with us at Foundation Source to make sure that the program is as complete as possible. Now, in terms of these record-keeping requirements, these types of grants typically require that a foundation obtain annual and final reports, that they retain information used to evaluate grantees and possibly to investigate suspected diversions of funds, and also to ensure that you've screened out grantees who are insiders or disqualified persons. And bear in mind that in many cases, especially with scholarship grants, there's a rule in the regulations that provides that many of these requirements are actually waived or relaxed, provided that the foundation make the scholarship grant payment directly to the university rather than to the individual scholarship recipient. And when you do so, you tell the university, by the way, give the money back if they don't show up for class, they don't enroll or maintain a minimum GPA. So you sort of shifted the burden onto the university to make sure the person is actually enrolled, maintaining GPA, and so forth and so on. From there, we're going to move along to grants to U.S. non-public charities. Now, as with grants individuals, many are surprised to learn that foundations can, in fact, make grants to non-public charities. They can do so as long as special procedures are followed. These special procedures involve several steps collectively known as expenditure responsibility, or ER. So if I say ER, I'm talking about expenditure responsibility, not the emergency room. So the exercise of ER requires that the foundation conduct a grant inquiry, a pre-grant inquiry, which is essentially due diligence. And just like with any other expenditure that's of significance, the foundation would want to evaluate whether it thinks the grantee has the skill set, the experience, the expertise, the capability, and the financial stability to carry out the grant purpose. And the foundation and the grantee must enter into a written grant agreement, and that grant agreement must contain special terms that the regulations say must be in there. Those special terms include a requirement that the grantee repay any portion of the grant funds that are not used for the special charitable purpose, a requirement that they submit annual reports accounting for the use of the funds, and those reports are broken into financial and narrative descriptions of the project or the program, that they refrain from using the funds in a way that would have been prohibited to a foundation. So, for example, under no condition can a foundation expend funds for lobbying, right, or for electioneering. So the notion here is you can't get around that rule by making an ER grant to someone else and having them, you know, spend the funds on a project for lobbying. So if the foundation can't do it, it follows that if I'm making a grant, they can't do things I can't do. That's the notion there. And that they maintain books and records. It's also important, after all that, that the foundation properly report the fact that it's made these ER grants on its annual return, the 990 PF. And they have to continue doing so for as long as there are unspent grant funds, and they also must report the fact that they've made this grant in any year in which they received the report, even if all the funds have been spent out. So for example, if I made a grant in 2016, and all the funds were spent down in 16, but I get the report about it in 17, I would have to file an attachment to my return for 17, indicating that I had received the report in 17, even though all the funds were spent down last year. Now, the thing about ER is that really it's the powerful tool that a foundation can use to make grants to even for-profit organizations. And people's mouths drop open. They say, what? You can grant to Google or IBM? And I said, yes, you can, as long as it's for a charitable purpose. Now, when you make, think about it this way, when you make a grant to a public charity, you don't have to have an ER agreement because public charities, by their very charter documents and the way they operate, are constrained to use their funds only for charitable purposes, but certainly IBM and Google are not constrained to do so. That's why you have an ER agreement. You're contractually binding the grantee to use the funds for the stated charitable purpose. So in theory, if IBM were to set up a community library, right, open to one and all, and the foundation wanted to help fund the building construction of that library that's going to be open to the public free of charge and so forth, that would seem to be a legitimate charitable purpose. So why not? Other types of exempt organizations, such as C4s and C6s, civic associations and business leagues, also often have charitable programs that they run aside from whatever their core businesses or their core activities. And of course, foundations often make grants to other private foundations. But in this case, foundations can only make grants to another foundation. When that happens, only one of the two foundations can count the distribution of those funds towards meeting its 5% payout requirement. So those in the room probably know that foundations actually have an annual 5% payout requirement. And the notion here is like this. Let's say I'm foundation number one, and here's foundation number two, right? So the idea is, if you didn't have this rule, here's what would happen. I'd say, oh, hi, foundation, let me make my grant to you this year and satisfy my payout requirement. Great. And then next year, here, let me pass those same funds back to you, and we'll go back and forth until we're dizzy, and the same grant funds would only be passed back and forth between those two foundations. So to ensure that things like that don't happen, you have a requirement that only one can count their actual redistribution of those funds towards meeting its 5% payout requirement. So if the grantor foundation wants to count it that way, the grantee has to agree to distribute all those grant funds by the end of its next tax year, and that when it does so, that it refrain from counting those grants towards its own 5% payout requirement. That's the notion. So a foundation may also wish to exercise expenditure responsibility when making a grant to a nascent or a new public charity. You say, well, what for? Why? I mean, because typically, as I'm sure we all know, when you apply for a recognition of tax exemption, file your 1023, it's typically retroactive to the date of formation. So if someone says, you know, I have a new public charity, you know, make a grant to me, why bother with the ER? Well, so look, in my experience, most of the time that works out just fine. But sometimes, guess what, it doesn't. Because sometimes they don't have the financial, you know, projections they need to sustain a finding that they're a public charity. There may be an issue and they might say, you know what, we're going to change this to be actually a foundation application, or we're going to be a C4 instead of a C3, or maybe there's a flaw in the way the attorney or whoever it was set up their charter documents, and there's a deficiency that has to be corrected, and it's corrected, but the determination is not retroactive to the formation in that case. If there's a fatal flaw with the bylaws or the articles, in that case it may be retroactive only to the date you corrected the charter documents. So to the extent that you make a grant before a charity has even filed a 1023 or received the termination letter, I think of it as sort of like a prophylactic, you know, measure, and it's not really that hard to do, and it certainly protects the client and avoids an awkward situation where, like, we didn't get the public charity classification. You don't really want to have those kinds of classifications or conversations to figure out what to do about it. We're going to move from there to international grants, and foundations have even more flexibility in making international grants than when they're making domestic grants. Because aside from exercising ER, which is always an option, foundation doesn't even need special procedures if they make a grant to a foreign organization that has filed the 1023 with the IRS and has been classified by the IRS as a public charity. Also, an organization that's been designated as an international organization by executive order, like the UN, does not need any special procedures. And a foreign government or its political subdivision also does not need special procedures, but in that case, you have to specify that the grant is for a charitable purpose. You can't make a general purpose grant to, you know, the government of Italy, for example. Otherwise, a foundation, again, can exercise ER, or they have yet another option, which is to make an equivalency determination. An equivalency determination is made by gathering the sort of information that the foreign organization would have submitted to the IRS with a 1023 application. So that means it would be, for example, their charter documents, their bylaws, their financial projections, their history of fundraising and public support and the like. And then you have to be able to make a determination that the IRS in this hypothetical alternate parallel universe likely would have classified the IRS based on that information as a public charity. So if you can make that sort of determination, you could make a grant to them like you'd make a grant to the Red Cross without expenditure responsibility, even general purpose grants. Now, typically in making an equivalence determination, foundation will obtain written advice that's based on current information from a qualified tax practitioner. Now, in former days, the way that would work is that they would go to an attorney and it required an opinion letter from counsel. The regulations were revised recently, though, or last year, maybe slightly before, to expand the scope of folks who are able to issue this written advice. So now, aside from attorneys, it also includes CPAs and enrolled agents, essentially folks who are bound and governed by Circular 230. That's the idea. So the thing is, people obtained these written opinions from these qualified tax practitioners because the IRS pays special credence to them. They don't use the term rebuttable presumption, but effectively it's along those lines. They respect the fact that it's probably been done correctly. Now, foundations can also obtain these determinations from centralized repositories. There's at least one called, for example, NGO Source. I'm sure some folks in the room are familiar with that organization, and they can also provide those determinations for your clients relatively inexpensively. So in terms of foundation expenses, it's another area where a foundation stands apart from donor-advised funds in its ability to pay reasonable and necessary expenses, those that are typical and helpful for a foundation to occur. In other words, a foundation's expenses must always be incurred to further a valid foundation purpose, including covering its own overhead expenses. Think of a foundation as a charitable business. If you're running a business, you wouldn't fritter away the business's resources. Whether it's a business that's large or small, there's a duty to be a good steward of the company's assets and to steer clear of lavish or excessive or unhelpful expenses. Same thing in a foundation. Now, expenses typically are classified as either investment-related or charitable. Investment-related expenses would include bank or advisory fees, and those expenses related to obtaining or maintaining investment assets. These expenses offset investment income and reduce the foundation's nominal excise tax liability. Other overhead and non-investment related expenses, such as legal fees, what you would pay salary for a program officer, and your grants, of course, count towards satisfying the foundation's 5% payout requirement. And expenses may be paid directly by the foundation or reimbursed to those who lay out the funds, even if those persons are disqualified persons or insiders. Now, note that if expenses are reimbursed, like with any employer, it's important to adhere to accountable plan rules to make sure you have your receipts and adequate record keeping for those expenses. Here's some common examples, just a few. Travel expenses for a site visit, legal advice, hiring a staff or consultant. And also bear in mind that sometimes even a single expense needs to be broken apart or bifurcated. Suppose you give your client a legal bill. It's $10,000, and of that legal bill, $7,000 was spent in negotiating an operating agreement for an investment the foundation would like to make, and let's say $3,000 of that had to do with amending their bylaws. In that case, it would be inappropriate to treat the foundation's expenditure, entirely towards meeting its 5% payout requirement. No, rather, the piece that had to do with the negotiations of the investment, the $7,000 piece, that would be an investment expense. A $3,000 for amending the bylaws would be a charitable expenditure that would count towards their 5% payout requirement. Direct charitable activities are another way that foundations are distinguished from donor-advised funds, is that it has the ability to carry out its own programs in addition to making traditional grants. In other words, a foundation can carry out a silo of activities in which the foundation acts as though it were a public charity. Whether that's hiring staff, renting space, paying utility bills, all those expenses count towards meeting the foundation's 5% payout requirement the same way a grant would. And this could take the form, for instance, of running a soup kitchen, an after-school enrichment program for kids in public school, or hiring a dermatologist to laser gang tattoos off the knuckles of ex-convicts. I can't make this stuff up, folks. These are real examples. So why conduct a DCA or a direct charitable activity at all? Because maybe the foundation has special expertise or vision. Maybe the foundation folks, we want to get down in the trenches. Sometimes folks on the foundation may have the capacity, the ability to promote collaboration among multiple funders or grantees, or perhaps a desire to inform public policy or advance public knowledge for a charitable area. The thing about direct charitable activities is that generally, they're reported in a separate place on the return in an informational capacity. In other words, you have a section on the return where you have a few sentences you could use to describe the nature of the activity, and it's a roll-up of all the expenses that have appeared elsewhere in the return. And that can actually be a very helpful thing, because you have the foundation in a particular year that, you know, has heavy expenses in running a program and is light on the grant making, the optics might not be that great, right? You might say, oh, what kind of foundation is this? They don't make grants, they have all these expenses. And then you go, oh, I see, they're running a program, they're running a soup kitchen, that's why they had all those expenses. So that could be your friend, you know, reporting the fact that you have a direct charitable activity. Naturally, foundations are also unique in that they're able to pay compensation if doing so would be helpful and appropriate for the foundation to fulfill its charitable purposes. Of course, under no circumstances can a foundation ever pay excessive and lavish compensation, and special considerations apply when compensation is paid to a disqualified person, an insider. Also, bear in mind that as an employer, foundations must be careful and correctly classify the people they're paying as either employees or independent contractors, and they may be conferring with you about making that evaluation. So, although self-dealing rules tend to be strict and generally prohibit financial transactions between a foundation and its insiders, there's an exception as long as the compensation is reasonable in amount and the services are personal services. And the annoying thing is that the regulations don't actually define the term personal services, but they give examples of what that would be, which includes, fortunately, legal fees, also includes investment counseling and banking services. And then there's a bunch of letter rulings and other guidance the IRS has issued that indicate that it typically extends to professional and managerial type of activities, but by contrast, there's one horrible case out there, everyone hates it, the Madden case, where they indicated that things like manual labor, like landscaping, and other ministerial types of activities would not constitute a personal service. And to determine what a compensation level, what is reasonable in amount, foundations look at what we call the like rule. What's the like rule? It's what foundations of like size or budget would pay to folks with like levels of experience in a like geographic area for like services, again, for like work and for like number of hours, part-time, full-time, so a lot of likes in there. I only use three, but that's the idea. And foundations typically follow the procedures that are set out there for public charities and determine in terms of documenting concurrently their decision to award this compensation and the basis for which the compensation was made. Here we have a quick review of set-asides. Now, the general rule for foundations is that even if they are on the accrual basis method of accounting, when it comes to satisfying the 5% payout requirement, they must use the cash method of accounting. And generally, of course, that means that they don't get to count an expenditure until it's actually expended. So if you make a pledge, for example, even if it's binding, the amount is fixed and certain, and you're going to pay next year, you can't count, you know, the actual making of the pledge towards meeting your 5% payout requirement. That's the general rule. An exception to that rule is the set-aside. So if in a set-aside year, what you can actually do is set aside funds for a particular project or a program, and that project or a program typically is one that's better off carried out by setting the funds aside and not granting them right away. What would be an example of that? So one example could be, let's say you want to do some sort of big construction project, and the contractor won't even begin to break ground until you have set aside a certain amount of money. And if you're constantly making your payout requirement, you'll never be able to make that amount unless you invade your endowment. Well, you might want to invade your endowment. You may be permitted to do so, but I mean, you don't want to do so. So this way, you could kind of set aside funds and accumulate them as long as you actually distribute. It's not a free ride. You actually have to distribute those funds eventually. right, typically within 60 months. And there are different kinds of set-asides. You have a cash set-aside and a suitability set-aside. The notion here with a cash set-aside is that you don't need IRS approval to do it. It's generally intended for new foundations or foundations that are recently funded, and you don't have to establish to the IRS's satisfaction that this is an example of a grant that's better off, you know, performed by setting funds aside than making the payments immediately. By contrast, suitability set-aside is where you do need IRS approval, and you have to make that argument. Another example of this would be, for example, let's say you want to support a charity, and you want the charity to have skin in the game, right? So you don't want to just give them everything. You want them to try to do their own fundraising. So you might try to encourage them by saying, I'll set up a matching grant program. For every dollar you raise, I'll match you one or two or three or four, whatever it might be. So obviously you're better off not giving the money right away because they won't be incentivized, right? You want to hold it back, reserve it, and say, you know, hey, knock yourself out, do as best as well as you can, and then we'll match it. So that's another example where there is guidance in the IRS, from the IRS, approving these kinds of suitability set-aside programs. And finally, we come to program-related investments. The program-related investment, or PRI, if I use the acronym, is an exception to the jeopardizing investment rules. Jeopardizing investment rules are generally intended to ensure that foundations are good stewards of their assets, that they don't make investments in an imprudent, you know, wild, you know, manner without looking and taking into account the short and long-term interests of the foundations. Now, the folks who drafted the regulations realized that there could be an exception. Sometimes a foundation wants to make an investment that's not motivated by a desire to secure a financial return, but rather an investment motivated to secure a social or charitable return on the investment. In a case like that, it would be wrong to hold a foundation's managers accountable and culpable for making investments that might be imprudent but secure a really valid and worthwhile charitable return. And so you have the PRI, the exception to those rules. Not only to the federal rules, but typically state law governing charitable endowments like UPMIFA or UPIA also have carve-outs, exceptions for program-related investments. For tax purposes, the PRI is treated as though it were a grant. So when you make the investment, even though it's an asset on your balance sheet, it counts towards your 5% payout requirement, just like a grant would. But because it's treated like a grant, if you're making a grant to a non-public charity as an equity investment or a loan guarantee perhaps, in all those cases, you need to exercise expenditure responsibility, ER, and obtain reports and so forth and so on. Another advantage of having made a PRI is that the PRI as a charitable asset is excluded from the asset base that drives the foundation's 5% payout requirement. So for example, if I invest $1 million of the foundation's assets in Google stock and I have a 5% payout requirement, 5% times $1 million is $50,000, right? So every year the foundation will have a $50,000 payout requirement on account of owning that $1 million of Google stock. But if I make a $1 million loan, for example, that's a PRI, that loan will never give rise to a $50,000 payout requirement as long as it remains a PRI. So it could be a very, very useful tool, and as well as being accepted from the jeopardizing investment rules, there's a set of rules called the excess business holding rules that tend to limit a foundation's ownership stake in a business enterprise, but there is an exception for a PRI. So even if you have an entity that's running a business, if it's advancing a charitable purpose of the foundation, it will count towards the foundation's 5% payout requirement, and it will be accepted from these excess business holding rules. Now, there are only three requirements, and we're just about at the very end of this. There are only three requirements. One is that the primary purpose of this charitable investment, and it has to be intentionally done from the outset to be a PRI. It can't be something that, you know, in hindsight, coincidentally, it did some charitable good thing, so I'm going to now call it a PRI. No, you have to have had the mental intent when you did this to accomplish a charitable purpose, and it has to be a charitable purpose that significantly furthers the foundation's exempt purposes. Also, the production of income or the appreciation of property can't be a significant purpose of having made the investment. So how do you know that? So typically, you would ask yourself, well, would a commercial investor find these deal terms attractive or not? Or if the foundation is sophisticated enough to have an investment policy, you might ask yourself, would this investment flunk the screen in the investment policy. Those are actually very good indicators, because ironically, the more imprudent the investment is, the more likely it is to be charitably motivated. And the foundation can't use make a PRI that's used for electioneering or lobbying. So those are all critical factors of it. And again, it could take the form of a loan, whether interest-bearing or non-interest-bearing, secured or unsecured, an equity investment, or a loan guarantee. This diagram kind of shows the fact that PRIs straddle this middle ground between a traditional grant and a traditional investment. And think of it really as a hybrid sort of investment. And that really brings us to the end of the presentation. So thank you for coming. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to take them now. So when it comes to making grants to individuals, over the years that we've been around, we've been working with the IRS in sort of a back-channel diplomacy. We've developed forms that have actually been published in some treatises by Jody Blazek and others, because they take into account all the various factors and record-keeping requirements are embedded within the forms themselves for emergency grants, medical distress grants, hardship assistance for making a financial evaluation of need. In all these cases, though, the program that we've run by the IRS and that these forms are geared towards are grants that are no more than $5,000 per year per household. Because if it were more than that, it's not like there's a hard cap that you can only grant $5,000. There's no such cap. It's just that in speaking again with the IRS, their feeling was that, all right, for $5,000 worth of grant funds, what you're doing, the information you're obtaining and that you're looking at is fine, that you're capturing in these forms. It was really more than that. You'd have to start looking at things like tax returns and utility bills and rent statements and things like that, that typically foundations don't want to get down in the trenches and do. And typically $5,000 could really make quite the difference. So we're always happy to speak with attorneys. We're terrific issue spotters. We'd be the first ones to say, well, this is more than $5,000, just outside the parameters of what we typically work with, but we'd be happy to work with your counsel. And we often work with counsel on these and other matters, including, for example, filing at 1023. So if you have a 1023 and you want to ask for approval of your grant to individual program, as we covered earlier in the presentation, it's not necessary at all for us to file the 1023. Just wanted to make clear, we're more than happy to work with entities that you set up, whether it's trusts in Delaware, Nevada. We have clients in over 40 states. So we're always happy to look at your 1023 applications, provide input, feedback on the 1023, grants individuals, or any other topic. Anything else? Yes. So we have folks at the back of the room. I'll get my head handed to me if I start talking about costs. So have mercy on me. At the back of the room, we have folks that could talk to you about costs. Yes. Okay, so the question for the room is, how much, you know, should a foundation be funded with? So we typically say to our clients that, you know, we hope they would start at least with $250,000. Now that might shock a lot of people and raise a lot of eyebrows. And that's because at least when I was in private practice, I would never have thought the number would be that low, right? I would have said at least a few million dollars, except that we spent the last 16 years developing this online platform and all these procedures where we've democratized our ability to parlay our services and our knowledge to your client's benefit. And because we can scale technology, we can produce returns, we can provide infrastructure and structure, large or small, and we've significantly brought down the costs. That's not to say that the bulk of our clients are that small. By far and away, they're not. Our largest client, for example, is $2.5 billion, and we have many clients in the single millions or double-digit millions and more. But at least $250,000 typically is we think is a good place to start. Yes. The question is, can a foundation make a grant to a donor-advised fund? And the answer is yes, it certainly can. And in fact, many of our foundations are paired with donor-advised funds. That could be useful if the foundation, for example, may want to make an anonymous grant, or, for example, the foundation just can't quite get its act together to figure out to whom they wish to grant by the end of the year, so to make their 5% payout requirement this sort of emergency, you know, release valve, pressure valve, they might make a grant to a donor advised funds, and after they had more time to deliberate about what they want to do with their budget, they'll make the expenditure in due course from the donor advised fund. Yes. So the question is, the foundation source support MRIs? So that's an interesting question. Let me just clarify, an MRI, for those not familiar with the acronym, since I didn't mention it today, is a mission-related investment. I typically think of a mission-related investment as a straight-up investment that is geared towards securing a financial return. However, it may have a positive impact. So just to be very clear, Foundation Source does not provide any sort of investment advice. We don't custody assets, and that really sets us apart from pretty much anyone else out there who provides day-to-day compliance services, because they typically want to manage the money or custody the assets, and we don't do that at all. We work with over 200 different banks and brokerage firms around the country. And so we would not advise our clients on the appropriateness of making an investment. We'd refer them back to their investment advisors or counsel. Sure. Any other brave folk out there? Yes. The question is, how do you assess whether an investment is an MRI or a PRI? So that's also a very good question. And so a lot of times it comes down to whether or not the motive for making the investment is the impetus is for a desire to achieve a financial return on the investment. And as I said earlier, that could be a very fine-grained decision. And typically the litmus is, would a commercial investor find those deal terms attractive or not? Does it pass the foundation's own screens? So it's always, by the way, in a case like that where it may be a close call, I find it extremely helpful to document contemporaneously before or as you're making the grant that you're doing this. I'd also mention that the IRS recently provided guidance indicating that the jeopardizing investment regulations that were issued in the 1970s can be interpreted in such a way to take into account a desire to achieve a social return on the investment. See, those regulations that were drafted in the 70s, they have a whole bunch of financial considerations, like the risk of rising and falling prices and, you know, deflation and inflation, need for diversification and the like. There's not a hint, there's not a lick of any intent to take into account anything but financial considerations. However, we now know that you can, in fact, take into account an investment's special relationship with the foundation's purpose. So MRIs would expand the universe of what would be considered nowadays prudent. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. I'll be here available after for questions. Thank you.